if you want to know how to play every key on that thing with one hand, look over there. Amen. God bless you too. Before we begin, will you pray with me? God, we thank you for the power of prayer. And we thank you, God, for this pocket-sized prayer that we're learning to pray, because, God, it's got four simple elements, but they can change us. So, God, hear this offering to you today. May it be a blessing to those who hear it. God, I thank you for the prayers that have saved my life. And I ask, God, that as we continue to pray for our friends, our enemies, and even the world, we know that things will change. Change us, God, in the name of Jesus, who is the change maker. Amen. So a couple weeks ago, we embarked on our second consecutive sermon series on prayer, based on this time the book by Max Lucado entitled Before Amen. Lucado says, we all pray, at least some. Prayer is a fairly universal endeavor, and yet he said, I would suspect that the majority of us would like to pray more, to pray longer, to pray stronger, with more fire, faith, and fervency. Thankfully, he says, we aren't the first to struggle with prayer. In fact, the first followers of Jesus needed prayer guidance too. In fact, the only tutorial he said they ever requested was a tutorial on prayer. Jesus gave them a prayer, not a lecture nor doctrine on prayer. Jesus gave them a quotable, repeatable, portable-sized prayer to help them get through their toughest needs. Lucado says the prayers of the Bible, if you read all of them, can be reduced essentially to these four things. God, you're good. I need help. So do they. Thank you. We spent the first week exploring the idea that God is good, and the three things that I recommended that I know about the goodness of God is that God has done great things, good things. God continually works all things together for our good. And lastly, I suggested that we can trust God to be good in the future because God has done good things, and God works all things together for our good, even when they don't look good. Last week, we took a long, hard look at the second sentence in this pocket-sized prayer, I need help. We've all reached that point, sometimes otherwise known as rock bottom, and we reach out to God for help. And here's what I said I knew about in times like these that we can count on, and I offered up for our consideration last week. Number one, God is our greatest help. Number two, Jesus never turned down a request to help. And thirdly, help is just a prayer away. This week, we delve into the third simple sentence in this pocket-sized prayer. They need help, too. Since others, the they, need help, just as we need help, I believe the best thing we can do for others is pray for them. And I believe our scripture lesson for today gives us a clue about this. The Apostle Paul said in the letter to the Ephesians that, as Craig read in the Contemporary Word, God can do far more than we could ever ask or imagine, according to God's riches in glory. What we can't do, God certainly can do. So we pray for others, for those who are in need, for those who also need help. But who are they? Now, I've heard of they. Y'all be talking all the time about they said. You know, they've been saying. I don't know they. I've never met a person named they. And don't come to me with they, because I don't know they. But I will offer up for our consideration this, y'all think I'm kidding, for our consideration this morning, here's who they is, okay? Number one, our friends, those that we love. Secondly, our enemies, those we don't. And number three, the world, those we don't yet know. So when we think of the they as our friends, that's a fairly simple task, right, to pray for our friends. When the challenges your friends are facing are greater than you are, you hurt alongside them. We had a situation in spiritual transformation where somebody that is in great need of prayer spoke. And everybody in here, I was a babbling idiot. I was crying. I was sobbing. But I trusted that this person knows that not only myself, but every single other person in that room was praying for their situation right at that moment. We pray for our friends. When we feel helpless, when there's nothing else we can do, we turn to God on their behalf. When the disciples asked Jesus for that tutorial on prayer, when they asked Jesus to teach us, God, how to pray, Jesus gave them the prayer that we read, that we recite every single week after the prayers of the people. We know it as the Lord's Prayer, and we conclude that prayer that we pray for the world every week by saying that prayer. But Jesus went on right after he gave them this prayer to give them this story about prayer that Craig read about. We find it in the 11th chapter of Luke's gospel. That was part of the contemporary word. Jesus said, imagine what would happen if you went to a friend in the middle of the night and said, friend, loan me 3 loaves of bread. Not one, but 3. 3's good, right? We love 3s. Friend, lend me 3 loaves. An old friend traveling through just showed up, and I don't have a thing on hand. I told him earlier, don't come to my house because you will starve to death. But this dude went to the house next door, and he began asking. And the friend answered from his bed, don't bother me. The door's locked. The kids are in bed, and I can't get up to give you anything. But let me tell you, Jesus said, even if he won't get up because he's a friend, if you stand your ground and you keep on knocking and waking up not just him but all the neighbors, then he'll eventually get up and give you whatever you need. Be persistent, Jesus instructs us. Here's what I'm saying, Jesus said. He narrowed it down to this. Ask and you get. Seek and you find. Knock and the door will eventually be opened to you. Don't bargain with God, Jesus said. Be direct. Ask for what you need. Be specific, saints. Ask him for just what you need. And I'll add, ask for what they need. Ask on behalf of your friends. I don't know about you, but there have been times in my life when I didn't know what I needed. I knew I needed something, but I didn't know what I specifically needed. And I've had some friends. I'm thankful for those friends who knew exactly what I needed. I told them this story earlier. I was in a previous relationship many years ago, and I traveled 56 miles one way to get to my job, and so I had a lot of time in the car and traffic and stuff in the morning. And so I called this one friend of mine, and she and I talked almost every morning, and she's a good friend to this day. I just texted with her right before the first service began, and I would complain and complain and complain about my partner and her drug addiction and all the things on and on. And my friend finally, after seriously about 8 months of just on and on and on and on, she finally stopped me. She interrupted me and said, Terry, I hope one day you love yourself enough not to put up with that mess. Y'all, that changed my life. And I didn't immediately walk away from that situation, but that phrase goes over and over in my mind every time I think of myself when I'm in a situation where I think, don't put up with this any longer. Or when I look at you and I see something in your life and I think, love yourself enough not to put up with this mess. She did not say mess anymore, right? Because it was that bad, okay? It was really bad. But I am grateful for those people who know what I need and lift up my need on my behalf before God, who can do things we cannot do. I am so thankful that God gives us this privilege and the power of prayer so that things can change not only in my life, but in the lives of those I love. But what if there comes a time when you gotta pray for those you don't love? Oh, that gets a little harder. It's easy to pray for those of you we love, but when you don't like somebody, oh, Jesus, that gets hard, right? You want to do anything but pray for them, right? Right? But I believe Jesus instructed in the scripture lesson, when somebody is against you, when they slap you, turn the other cheek. Now, that's hard, but do it, right? When they ask for your coat, give them your shirt too. When people ask on your behalf, do unto others, he said, as you would have them do to you. I don't know about you, but that's really difficult to do when Jesus reminds us. He said, love your neighbor. And in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, you've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. For God makes the sun to rise on the evil and on the good. Jesus goes to breaking social norms again. It's simple and commonplace, in fact, to pray for our friends, but to pray for enemies. Jesus has gone a little too far, right, we think. But then, when you think about it, what's the best way to solve a problem? Pray for them, right? I remember a friend of mine, a pastor that I had one time, we were in Bible study, and somebody was having difficulty with, I think it was a coworker or something like that, and she said, "Have you prayed for them?" And we all got thinking, I thought, man, I don't do that either. And the person that she was kind of talking to said, "Actually, no, I haven't." And she said, "Pray for him for 30 days and see what changes." And you know, 30 days later, she said, "Things really haven't changed, but I have. I've let go of the issue. I've let go of the concern. I just don't worry about it anymore." And I believe that if we can do that, if we can continue to pray for others, even when we don't see eye to eye, I believe God can level that ability to see one another. The Apostle Paul quoted in the 10th chapter of the book of Romans, and he quoted from Solomon's wisdom literature in Proverbs. He said, "If your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they're thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will reap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." The Message version says it this way: our scriptures tell us that if you see your enemy hungry, go buy that person lunch. And if he's thirsty, get him a drink. Your generosity will surprise him with goodness. Don't let evil get the best of you. Get the best of evil by doing good. Moses found himself in that similar type of predicament. His friends, if you will, those fellow Hebrews that had been delivered from slavery in Egypt and had walked through the Red Sea on dry ground with Moses as their leader, those folks had eventually turned against him. You ever been there? You ever had people that used to be your friend that ain't quite your friend no more, and then you realize that I'm in the enemy's camp now. I thought I was with Moses. Was just like that. The people had been complaining. God had provided them. They're wandering in the wilderness for 40 years, a path that should have taken 11 days, took them 40 years. We've all been there too. And they got hungry, and so God gave them manna by day and evidently very dry quail by night. And they weren't happy. It was just not tasty enough. And they desired the food that they ate while they were in bondage. You see, even in bondage, you get 3 squares a day, right? And a cot and a pillow, right? And so they longed for those days. Have you ever looked back? And have you ever longed for what was back there? Have you ever, it looked so good, what used to be. And you know why it looked good? Because it was comfortable. Because it's what you already knew. That food was not good. It was not good. But we think, you know what? It was at least rice in the morning and beans in the afternoon and steak at night, you know. And here we complaining about quail and manna, but I've got something to eat. But these people, they were thirsty. The Israelites were thirsty, and there was no water in the desert. And so they start complaining to Moses. They're like, "Look, dude, you got to do something about this. We are thirsty." And Moses tried to remind them of where they've been and what God had done. And they said, "You know what? What God's done in the past don't matter because we're thirsty. And what God's going to do in the future don't matter because we're thirsty." And what does God do? God tells Moses. Moses goes to the mountain and says, "God, what am I going to do with them? What am I going to do with all these people? They're complaining and they're whining and they're moaning about what they have and what you've provided for them. And it's just not good enough." Can't say amen, say ouch, right? And God, they're complaining. And God allowed Moses to complain for a minute, and then he said, "Strike the rock." And the rock provides this water to flow, and they had just what they needed. Now, it was not the best. It was not Dasani, okay? It was just water coming out of the rock. But God provided what they needed. Saints, how many times does God provide what we need? And we still want to whine and moan, because you know what? We just used to whine and moan, right? And God asks us. So sometimes when that happens, you got to start praying for them. You got to start praying when the whining happens. Perhaps if I start praying, things might change for me too. But I would imagine that Moses went to pray on behalf of his friends turned his enemies that had or his friends that turned enemies. And he was able to reach out on their behalf because they were so disgruntled they couldn't even pray. You've been there, right? Jesus was hanging on a cross. And the people around him, the guy next to him said, "If you really are the Son of God, get down and save all of us. Save yourself and the rest of us." The others down below him were gambling for his last piece of clothing. And they were jeering and sneering at him, and he was dying a death that he didn't deserve. And Jesus looked down when all those people were just doing what they do. Jesus said what? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Now, we might think we know what we're doing, but we don't know what we're doing, and we don't know the destruction that we're causing. I told them earlier, I was reminded that for many years, my father was an enemy of mine. And we fought, and we just butted heads all the time, and it was a struggle. It was a struggle, and one day, God opened my eyes. I complained about my daddy long enough, and God opened my eyes enough to see, and it finally occurred to me, you know what? My dad has done the best he could do with what he had been given and the life in which he had to live, and when I got over myself enough to realize my dad was doing not good enough, but the best he could do given his own situation and circumstances, I was able to let that go. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Saints, you're never more like Jesus more than when you're praying for somebody else. And I want to be a person who prays for other people, particularly my enemies. I want to pray for those with which I have political differences, as hard as it is. I want to pray for that man who walked in that club right down the street. I'm going to pray for those who influenced him. I'm going to pray for those who fear, just like he did. I'm going to pray for all those who would rather kill and use weapons to harm us than use a weapon as the power of prayer. I want to pray for those folks who are my enemies. Because when I do, I'll be like Jesus and things will change. When we do those things, when we can pray for our friends and we can pray for our enemies, we pray for those we love and those we don't, and then we pray for those we don't even know. We pray in advance for those we don't even know about yet. Max Lucado tells in his book that there was a gentleman that got hurt, and he was not doing well, and they rushed him to the hospital, and the kid that was hurt, everybody began praying, and the family started telling their friends, please pray for my kid, and it just went on, and people at different jobs started praying, and the kid said he died, and he was in heaven, he could see heaven, and he could see all these wonderful things, and then all of a sudden, he would see a flash of light and then other flashes of light. And he said, at one moment, there were thousands of lights flashing. And then he realized, he looked at God, and God said, all those lights are all these people down there praying for you. And then the kid said, God sent me back. You see, saints, sometimes our prayers can change somebody else's situation. And so I want to pray on behalf of those I don't yet know, those that God has not yet blessed me to know. And when I do, I know that things will change. I know Max says in his book also that he had gone to another church to preach there. And the pastor of that church, it was a fairly large, it was a mega church at the time. And Max Lucado's church at that point was not. And he said when they were teaching, the minister there told him, do you have a prayer team that prays for your ministry? Your prayer team that prays specifically for your church? And he said, honestly, I don't. And he said, go back and identify several people that will pray for your church and its ministry. And he said, within 6 months, their attendance had doubled, their offering was overflowing, because people specifically set out to pray. And so, saints, I know you pray, and I know you pray for Joy MCC, but I'm asking you specifically today to pray for this church. Pray for our ministry. I believe there is no doubt in my mind that we are situated on this property for a purpose. Do you realize this property was purchased in 1988, almost 30 years before Pulse happens, on purpose, because we would need to be a beacon of hope and light in the world when that crime happened. And I am grateful to be situated where we are, and I want us to pray. I want you to pray for this church. I want you to pray for its ministry. I want you to pray for the people that come through these doors on Sunday morning, on Sunday afternoon for discipleship, for Monday night for exercise that we all, particularly me, need to come to. We need to come on Tuesday nights when the choir is in here practicing so that they can lead us in worship. When we come in here on spiritual transformation and lives are changed and we pray with and for each other, I want you to pray every time these doors open, that somebody will be blessed,
There are AA meetings. There are grief groups because people are hurting, and I want you to pray for us because I believe God has greater things for us to do. And when we all set forward to pray, I know that God's going to change things, and I want God to start with me. I want to change so that I might be a change agent in the world. God has much work for us to do. And when others need it, we can turn to God on their behalf. I ask you to pray. I ask you to pray in the name of Jesus, because when we ask, we receive. When we seek, we find. When we knock, the door will be open for us. Why? Because Jesus said so. Prayer works because God does. In Jesus' name, amen.